Hello everyone, thanks for watching this. My name is Carlos Galvez. I'm the senior motion designer at BBC Studios in London, and I especially enjoy 3D design, my everyday job. So to start with, I'm going to play a little show reel with my latest work so that you can get an idea of the kind of work I do. So my history is in broadcast design mainly and branding design, and I started my career in Spain, where I'm from, first as an editor and then as a motion designer for TV, and then I spent some time freelancing for the Netherlands doing mainly branding design. So here are the ones to blame for my career choices, and these are some of the style frames for my very early projects. So some of these are quite embarrassing, so I'll skip this quickly. I think I discovered Cinema 4D in 2010 through Grayscale Gorilla, and it was a big game changer for me because it really felt like you were learning 3D along with the entire community. And in 2012, I got a job as broadcast designer for the BBC. So I moved to London, and I've been working for the BBC in one form or another since. So these are the frames from my more recent jobs. So I'm going to talk a bit about one of the campaigns I created for the BBC. Last year, I was lucky enough to create this campaign to celebrate the 50th anniversary of the moon landing for BBC Earth, one of our channels. And the brief was quite open, which is always good. We go back to the moon 50 years later to celebrate how the first trip inspired us. I'm going to show some of the frames from the original references from Pinterest. The creative director wanted to create a really strong contrast between the almost monochrome images of the moon that we all know with explosions of color, like the ones from the Holi Festival. So here's the final trailer.
Landing on the moon sparked more than a moment of joy. It opened our world to a whole new space. Celebrate the 50th anniversary of our greatest leap with programs that take you there and beyond. Continues all day today on BBC Earth.
I also have a little video on how the whole thing was done using Cinema 4D. So let's play it and then we'll dive into it.
Thank you.
Right. So let's jump into Cinema 4D and pick the most interesting parts. Right. So let me jump into the Cinema 4D files. But I'm going to make a very quick introduction so that you can understand my starting point. Basically, the whole thing started with the guidelines from the creative director was we actually needed the same spaceship that the original astronauts had in the 60s trip to the moon. So what we did is literally we went to TurboSquid and all those kind of websites and looked for the original one, looking at the original footage from the 60s and the original photos. So we found this was probably the closest, well, that's a bad example, but this is the Cinema 4D. It's already open. So this is the original spaceship from the 60s, or the closest we could find anyway. So we had to actually modify some things. Some of the colors are different, and the texture, we had to do a lot of work in like Photoshop and things like that. So this was the starting point for the character. And please bear in mind that I had pretty much no idea of what rigging really meant and how complicated it can get before embarking this project. So what I did was literally learning the basics for this project. And this is one of the reasons why I find Cinema 4D being so effective for these kind of projects. You can literally pick the minimum amount of information you actually need to work on a project. And that usually means you don't have to hire someone else to do the rigging or to do the animating, etc. So I'm going to go very briefly into the basics of how I did the basic animation for the character. And then I'll go into the most complicated animations in which I used Mixamo, which is a really useful tool. So first of all, let me visualize everything. This is the rigged model. And all these, with this view, you can actually see the joints, basically the bones and the model at the same time. It was really important to actually use layers. Depending on the projects, I don't use layers, but for this one, it was key. And it's a really powerful and useful tool. So what I did is very basically, I created two layers. One of them is the actual mesh, the geometry of the actual astronaut. And the other one is just the bones. So that way I can hide one or the other. And in doing so, what I can do is animate it without actually messing with anything from the geometry. So let's say I want to animate this arm. What I would do is, first of all, lock the geometry. You have this little icon here that means that you're going to lock the geometry and whatever you touch here, you're not going to mess with anything. However, I haven't locked the bones. So that's really important because I can literally pick this one and rotate it. Oh, wait. Why not? Why is it not working? Oh, this one is. Oh, now it's working. Right. So, I think it's all about. Let me see. Right, it is working, so I can actually come here and animate this one. It's only working sometimes. Why is that? Let me see. So it's working if I do it here, because this is a really handy way of animating. I know what it is. Basically, all these bones are already animated, and I don't want to do that. I want to start from scratch. I want a blank slate. So I'm going to literally delete all those frames, and I believe that's it. And yes, that's it. That's it. Okay, that's very important. This rig was a version that I already animated before, so it's very important to keep it without any keyframes or anything. Otherwise, you're going to mess up the whole thing. So, right, from this is the starting point. And if I want to animate one of the bones, remember, we go back to the layers. We've got the geometry locked. If you think that you don't have access to the actual joints, you can always literally hide the geometry. But anyway, in this case, it will do. So let's say I want to animate this arm. So it's very easy to come here directly and click on the joints, click them here, and that way, let's say I want to animate. I'm hitting W here, and I find that's a really useful shortcut. It means it changes the coordinate system basically from wall to object. If you're using the object, it's in keeping with this actual joint, and it's showing you the actual direction. But sometimes, especially for shoulders and those kind of joints, you want to hit W and have access to the world, to the world coordinate. So that's super useful for animating. And then another thing, let me undo that. Another very important thing that I found, it works really well, is once you have this original model in the T position, I like coming here, and every one of the joints, I like to click on them, and you see that the values are all messed up now, like the rotation is not zero. I like to zero out everything by freezing. So if you click freeze all, what this is going to do is transfer all these values from here to here. And that is very useful, because now you forget about those ones, and this is the T position, the original position. And that position is set at zero now. And that's super useful, because if I mess the whole thing now, say I move this to the wrong position, I can always come here and say, oh God, I'm going to set everything back to zero, and it will go to the right position. No, it didn't. Actually, it didn't. I think it's because, let me do it again. So I keep messing with this. I come back here, and remember that I've got this shortcut because it's really useful. All this does is it zeros, it basically changes all the values for zero. So if you come here, let me do it with this, again, I can move this all the way. Oh, this one wasn't. So if I come here, right? Let's say I want to keep this position as the original one, so I freeze all. And now, let's say I'm messing too much with this, it's just in the wrong axis and it's all messed up. I simply need to zero all these values out. I could even mess with the position, you see, and come back here, and it's always going to restore the original one. That's super useful, and at some point you're going to find that you are actually animating the axis in the wrong position. So again, that's a big one. Remember to always, and this is a, of course, the, you can find a situation in which you need to animate position, but when animating the bones, the joints, I find that you should always animate rotation. If you want to move the position of this elbow, I would animate the rotation of this shoulder. So remember, animating the position, it's always a bad idea. It's always going to mess things up. So unless you want to do something really weird with the bones and actually distort the character, if you want to keep it realistic, remember, rotation, and you can get very far from simply animating rotation. So I think that's it in terms of the basics. That's the way I rig the character, and that's the way I. That's literally all the skills I needed to start animating the very basic movement of the character on this promo, on this trailer. But for more complex animations, I'm going to dive into Mixamo, which is an amazing tool that I'm going to show you now, and that's basically for situation in which the character is performing a more complex animation, and I don't want to go into actually animating everything manually, and it's never going to look as natural as motion capture animation, which is what Mixamo is actually. So many people know this tool, and I knew it before starting on this project, but I hadn't really used it so extensively, because you can, there are so many things you can do with it. First of all, what I want to do, and in order to do this, I'm going to show you the first scene in which we are going to work on. It's not on the trailer you just saw. It's one of the items that we created for the campaign. And it was literally the astronaut performing a bit of a moonwalk. So I'm going to play it for you guys. Right, so that's it. So in order to create that, it's really easy with Mixamo. If you remember, if you had to animate that manually, that would take forever. So I can come here and look for moonwalk, and Mixamo is going to show you different options. We have a couple of them here. I don't remember which. Well, I guess, yeah, I guess this is the one. So I can literally come here, and it will preview the animation on my character. The only reason why it's actually applying it to my model is because I loaded it before, but let me go back a bit and try and explain how you do it. You have two options, basically. Option one is I can upload my model here, and it will apply this specific animation to it. And the great thing about that is that I can apply any other animation. I could click on hip hop dancing and it will still apply to the same model. So that's brilliant. So let me show you first how to do that. Let me upload character. So it's asking for these three formats. So I'm going to try and see if I have, I think FBX was the one that I found. No, actually object. The OBJ is the one that works best for me. So that was a simplified version of my character. And remember, it needs to be on the T position. That's the only thing. So you need to keep it on that position so that it recognizes all the axes. Brilliant. So orient, yeah, that's right. Next, and now very quickly, you just need to position the main joints. That's it. Oh, sorry, that's a groin. Right. Auto rigging. Boom. We've got it. So now the great thing is, as I said, it's going to apply any movement you want to your model. I'm trying with moonwalk, but let me, let me try walk. It's going to apply everything to your model, except that it's going to do it in a more, let's say, in a less controlled way. So you don't have control over every single item as you would do if you do it manually, which is the second technique I'm going to show you, and it's the one that I actually ended up using for this project. So let me go back to the moonwalk animation. This is the one I want. And the great thing is you can actually animate, let's say, the overdrive. I wanna do it very slow because, actually that doesn't make sense, but animations in space are usually very slow, it doesn't make sense because you could actually move very quickly in space. You don't have any resistance or anything. But anyway, I try and keep it consistent with the way, to what we are used to see in the movies. And this astronaut is kind of moving in a very kind of slow way. You can animate the head so that it's actually looking at the, maybe at the front. Maybe not that much. The arm space should be quite big because that spacesuit is massive. And I wanna have as much animation as possible. Right, so let's say I want to have this animation, so I just have to download it. Of course, pick the right frame rate, pick the right, if you want it with the actual geometry or not. I ended up using, yes, the bones in this case, but but let's download it with skin, and you can always get rid of it. And of course the format, so let's hit download. Boom, we've got it right here. I believe I downloaded it in FBX, so let me open it in Cinema 4D. I'll leave all those things by default. And this is what we get, which is pretty amazing for something like this. Remember, I didn't save textures or anything, but you can keep your textures. So this is amazing for simple characters, but my problem was there's so many tiny bits in this character that I ended up simplifying. I don't want these metals to actually to be stretched and modified, because that's supposed to be metal, that's supposed to stay. Same thing with the backpack, that's the most obvious thing, which has an easy solution. I can literally just wait. I can literally click in backpack and say, let me go back to the first frame and say, don't apply that the skin animation. I would have to do the same with this and go put this back in the right position and make it a child of the body, and it will stay in place. However, I found that this is not the best way forward, because I find that I ended up undoing a lot of stuff. So what I ended up doing is I got rid of all this and only used the bones. And I found that was more, it gave me more freedom to actually animate the things in the way I want. And this is the key thing. This is the actual motion capture information that I'm going to need. So let me go back to the original model. I'm going to copy. Oh, actually, I'm going to do it the other way around. I'm going to copy this here. Right, so this is the second way. I'm going to show you how I did it in the end, which is only using the bones from Mixamo and applying them to this mesh. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to delete the bones I created from my original model to put in the D position. Oh, sorry. You see, that's one of the reasons. If I delete the bones, it's going to delete a bunch of stuff. And it's usually the hard stuff, let's put it that way. It's the backpack, it's the metal bits that I was talking about, and the helmet. Why? Because I don't want that to be modified. I don't want those objects to have a skin tag, which basically means it's going to stretch all those things. Instead, I want those objects to be inside the bones, because those bones are going to be, remember, stretching and moving the actual mesh, the geometry. So if you make something the child of one specific joint, it's going to keep it in that place without modifying it. So let me show you that. I'm going to click on the backpack. Here it is. Where is the backpack? Right, the backpack is linked to. This is the backpack, it's linked to the neck, actually. Well, that's interesting. So I decided to make the backpack a child of this specific joint, because that way, if I animate this, if I animate, say, the position of the neck, spine. Oh, that's the one, yeah. So if I animate this, if I animate the spine, it's going to move the whole thing. Which is quite interesting, because if I rotate this, it will, as you can see, it will stretch the body, which is the soft part, but it will keep the backpack in the right position. So very simply put, that's all I did in terms of putting the hard bits inside the joints. Right, so in order to show you how I did this, let me use the model that I downloaded, because that's probably the best way of doing it. So the second way in which I actually animated the, or rather linked the Mixamo bones to the existing model, to the geometry, is definitely more time consuming, but it's more, you've got, in a way, you have more options and you can personalize it more, and further down the line you're going to find that it has some advantages. So the first thing I'm going to do, this is the animation I'm going to select everything. This is the animation of the bones. So I'm going to click and select my model and to try and make it exactly the same size so that I don't have to mess with all those things later on. Otherwise it's going to stretch the whole thing. Right. That's maybe a bit bigger. Let me use, it's definitely easier to do in this view. Right, that makes sense. So now the main thing I'm going to do is I'm going to select the specific bones, the specific joints, and place them in the right position. So remember, always using, let me lock the mess so I don't pick the wrong thing. I'm going to only move the rotation just like this, and I'm going to try and match the actual model. So again, this is a really, and every time I do, I'm going to create a keyframe, right? So that you have a new keyframe here and that stays in position. So I'm going to do it like this. Remember, always animate the rotation with the models you download from a Mixamo, otherwise you're gonna mess the whole thing. Right, so again, this is a really time-consuming process, but it pays off to do it this way. So I'm going to speed things up, and hopefully you will get the idea once it's done. Right, so this is the final scene. I sped things up so that you could actually see the final result. Remember, this one already has the textures and everything. It's got the backgrounds, and remember, I'm using V-Ray on this one specifically. I use V-Ray and Arnold for this project, but this scene is all V-Ray anyway. I've got my texture here. And right, as you can see, let me isolate the character, which is the main thing here. So the way I did it is I linked those bones to the mesh I had, to my model. And the way I did it is, once you have the bones, you select them all, select your model at the same time, and go to character. Let me select everything. We need to select children in here, so I've got a shortcut here. So again, characters. Bind. Why is it not? Oh, I think it's because I already hit bind. But anyway, yeah, you just select the bones, the model, characters, commands, and then bind. It's grayed out here because I already clicked that button, and then what it does is it creates on every single bit of mesh you have. This is a complex model anyway. It's called everything separated. So in every object you have, it's going to create this one tag. Well, it's not a tag. It's this one object, which is skin. And that's basically, you can always uncheck this one and it will put it in the original position, which is the T position. Here it is. I'm going to click it back. But the great thing is, if you do that, you have more control over what you want your character to do. And that's the way I did it anyway. got two camera positions in here, but that's the way it animates. I think I ended up using this camera. Yes, this is the one. So again, now it's animating the actual body in a different way to the backpack and the helmet and all the hard parts, basically. Those ones are attached to the joints, remember. And that's about it in terms of animating and rigging. Really basic. Anyone can learn this in literally a few hours, and you're set to go in a project like this. It doesn't really have any complicated... there is one thing that you need to know, actually. And it's might look like a small thing, but it can mess up the whole thing, which is the weight manager. Remember, this is the... Let me see. Yeah, this is the main body. So if I click in here, when I click bind, remember, if I go to character, commands, bind, this is the one, it's going to create this skin object and this tag. And this tag is really interesting because it actually selects every joint that is going to be linked to that mesh. So if I command double, no, I think it's shift, double click. Yes, that's right. I can shift double click. You can see that the colors change, and that means that remember to uncheck the hypernurbs every time you do that, because otherwise it's going to cover the interesting part, which is the coloring. If I select this, you see that super cool looking coloring here. That means that's super useful, because that means I can select the right hand or whatever, and it's going to highlight what it is. And if I think that this part should affect a bit more, I can always paint it. But of course, if I do it in that way, that's going to mess the whole thing. Look. Now it looks, it's not massive, the change I did, but it can mess the whole model anyway. So something that I found very interesting on this weight manager is, rather than painting manually, using the smooth mode. And you can apply all, and that's going to make the whole thing more, basically smoother. You can see it. Let me undo. You see that you can see some artifacts in here. If I click apply all in smooth mode, it's going to smooth that out. And of course, there's always a limit to this. If you do it too much, it's not going to look human. It's not going to look very interesting. But I found that that's super interesting. So that's about it in terms of rigging and animating. And so this is the next scene we're going to be looking at. And this is the way it looks. Right, so let's jump into Cinema 4D and see how the main settings work. What do we have in here? Basically, we have our character, our astronaut here, and we've looked into this whole animation part, so we kind of know that. But anyway, let me isolate the model. Remember, the astronaut, the main character is here, and we've got a camera right behind his shoulder. And that camera is slightly animated. It's one of those effects, I think some people call it vertigo effect, where you actually animate the focal distance and the position of the camera. I'm not a massive fan of overusing that, but I don't know. I wanted to try with this one, because one of the main points is, at the end of the shot, you want to see this flag in here to say that he is the original astronaut, that he's kind of coming back to the moon, and he's kind of looking at the immensity of the moon, etc. So let's look very quickly at the astronaut. And this is something I do all the time. I create a new scene and paste the model. And that way you can see it isolated. There are no textures on this folder, so everything is going to be messed up. And as you can see, if you look at the model after everything we looked at, it looks pretty wrong, actually. But the point is, it doesn't matter. All this bit doesn't really matter. And the legs, they don't even need to be there, because we're going to be looking from this perspective. And I think that was a big learning for me in terms of rigging and animating. Don't over animate. Don't over. Don't spend time doing things that you, the camera is not going to show. So, and that's why I find really useful to actually storyboard every shot. This is the only bit we need from the astronaut. So the rest doesn't really matter. It can be, you can even delete the geometry. It's not even going to show. Unless it's being reflected somewhere in the helmet or something like that, it's just unnecessary. So again, look at how ugly the whole model looks if you look from here. And that's because I kept animating this bit and I didn't pay attention to this, which is fine. It's totally fine. The camera is not going to be showing that. So again, the animation of the character is really simple. He's simply looking up because he's, let me go back to the other project. He's literally is looking up at the moon. And the way he's doing that is literally, let me go back to layers. Remember, this is key. I've got a few more layers in here. Essentially, I'm going to lock this, the geometry, and also, let me remove that. So I think there is a bit of animation in terms of his helmet is looking up, and then his elbow is kind of opening, and maybe a bit of animation on the shoulder. I'll look back now. Whoops, that's not the one. On the shoulder. So actually it's animating in this way. So again, super simple animation, but it hopefully gives you the idea that he's an actual character and he's not static and it's kind of moving. But the main work on this scene is basically the texturing and lighting. Let me render the scene so that you can see how it looks. And this was a big finding. I think when we are rendering 3D, we tend to overuse like global illumination and things reflecting lights, etc. And what I found is that if you look at the original footage of the moon, there's no global illumination in the space. And that's a big thing. That's the way images look on the moon, because of course there is a lot of compositing and depth of field, etc. But this shadow should stay pretty much black. And everything looks a bit staged. I wonder if that's the reason why so many people say that the moon landing was staged. But it should look like that because there's pretty much nothing bouncing light back to these areas. So again, the lights should be really black. I think I used one of these, I think it's a parallel spotlight. And then these are like fake lights. And when I say fake, I mean, I'm using these ones affecting only the character because I want it to look in a very specific way. If I render again, you will see that this kind of rim lighting is very cool, but it's not necessarily realistic. This wouldn't look like that unless there is some kind of spotlight that they are actually intentionally placing on the moon to isolate some lights or whatever. So I do this all the time, just faking lighting because it simply looks better. You don't have to stick to the way it would look. No one is going to say, well, that's not the way the lighting from the sun would look. So hopefully there is a bit of blue light, etc. All that is fake. Like I'm not sticking to the way the moon actually looks. And in terms of the surface, the soil, what I did is that there are different objects in here. It's not just one plane. So the plane that is closer to the camera has more subdivisions because I don't want it to be showing any artifacts or any polygons. And the ones that are farther away are using only a bump map, and that essentially speeds up things when you're rendering it. The whole thing is into a cloner, as you can see here, and that makes it look like it's very long, etc. And I think that's about it, and this is it. It's all about rendering and lighting. Right, so let's jump into the next one. This one is really simple. I'm going to pay a bit of attention to the compositing on this one because that's the main trick to make it work. And then we will jump into Cinema 4D and see how I animate everything. So, yeah, basically, this is the main animation. You've seen it before. It's the astronaut kind of jumping and flipping over, whatever, and having fun, and with the explosions in the background. These explosions, as you can imagine, are not X particles or anything like that. They literally are stock footage. So I cheated like that in most of the scenes because that's it was faster, more realistic, and yeah, we wanted to focus on the actual animation of the characters and backgrounds and rendering, etc. So as you can see, it's a fairly complex After Effects scene. Well, it's not really complex, it's just many layers, but hopefully you will get the idea. It's let's strip it off of everything. This is literally the background. Something that I wanted to point out is I always import the Cinema 4D scene and the project directly into After Effects. This is the way I do it with CineWare. And that's the way I don't need to render, you know, that you can jump into Cinema 4D and make a preview, picking software, OpenGL or hardware, whatever you want. And that's the way I used to do it. You can render one preview and then that's brilliant for animatic, for timing purposes, etc. But this is faster and it's more interactive, basically. You can jump into the Cinema 4D scene, change something and it will be automatically updated here. So as you can see, this CineWare plugin is literally refreshing, it's literally picking the project from here, from Cinema 4D, and it's doing it live. So what I've done on that one is I have placed a few nulls so that I can use them in After Effects for positioning the particles. So this, let's use this one. As you can see, I'm mixing this one with the animatic, which doesn't make sense, but this might be useful for you to have a look and get an idea of how the whole thing was integrated into the 3D space. So this is in 3D is basically picking the location that I set in the After Effects, in the Cinema 4D scene here with these different nodes in different positions, because those are the areas where I want to place the explosions of particles. I used an external compositing tag and saved them in the Cinema 4D project, and that means that it's going to be automatically updated here, and it's going to create nulls in After Effects, which are these are the original nulls that got imported when I imported the Cinema 4D project. And what all I did was literally replace the project, the nulls for these particle precomps, and that's going to keep those particles in place, consistent with the camera animation and everything. So again, old trick, but hopefully it works. You don't need to render everything at once. There is a lot of cheating, a lot of compositing on this one. And yeah, so you can see, those are the particles against that background. Some distortion there, some the shadows. All those shadows are done in compositing again. More particles. And more particles, and the astronaut is here, and I rendered the astronaut as a buffer object. Actually, it was a different project, and I rendered it in a different scene because I wanted to have it with a different lighting, and I didn't want the background to actually affect the character because it's actually too far away from this background. So you can cheat it that way, and it literally has a camera lens blur effect in After Effects, which works really well with this type of footage, or 3D render, rather. Some color correct, some flares, a bit of glow. The glow is more noticeable here, I think, where it's actually picking the whites. Yeah. Anyway, it's really, really small increments. You don't have to go all in with them. I think it usually makes more sense to create many layers with small increments rather than having one layer with, well, that doesn't make sense, with all the effects happening at once. And that's it. This is the way the final thing looks. And let's jump into the cinema 4D scene. Again, it's really simple. Remember, some of the most important things are the nodes that I said with... these are literally just objects that I create, right-click, cinema 4D tags, and I place an external compositing tag, and that means it's going to update it in After Effects and give you an X, Y, and Z position that is super useful if you're animating the camera as I am here. So that's going to keep the explosions consistent with the position of camera, the floor, all the lighting. And again, the lighting is super fake. I just want my character to have all that rim light happening behind him, even though, yeah, that's just for dramatic purposes. I really like that kind of, all those wrinkles lit in that way. And that's about it. This is a really simple scene. And we're going to move into the next one. Let's have a look at this one now. This is the overhead shot that you saw on the main trailer before. And again, really simple setup. It's just the particles exploding from these craters here. They're like 1, 2, 3, 4 positions. And this was actually synchronized with the music. So the timing was key. And that's the reason why we had to actually animate the whole thing in Premiere first for timing purposes, and then set all these X particles explosions synchronized with that original timing. And even though you see X particles exploding here, the final ones are mixed with stock footage, as you can see here. But the reason why I mix them with actual X particles is because that way you keep the perspective. As you can see, we have a camera pan from right to left, and the particles are still consistent with that camera move. And that's because some of the tiny ones are generated with X particles and are consistent with the camera movement, basically. If I stop right here, right, you can see that all those tiny particles are mixing very well with these ones. And hopefully that does the trick that makes you think that the particles are in the same Z space that as the camera is. So yeah, there are some reflections, some shadows being affected by the background. And let's have a quick look at this. In terms of background, as I said originally, these shadows are pretty much black in the moon. I was looking at the original images, and the great thing is that you can go to the, I think it's actually the NASA website, where you can actually download high-res images of the moon and some of the big planets in our solar system, and that's brilliant. But of course, for these kind of close-ups, I didn't have normal maps from the NASA website or bump maps or displacement maps, so I needed something more detailed, and you don't really need to be that accurate when it comes to the moon. It's okay if it looks like the moon. You don't actually need to stick to some specific area. So the way I did it is there is one plane here. This is a really useful shortcut. Scroll to first active. I use it all the time. I click in here and then find it with this one. In this case, it's really simple because it's right there. But I use it all the time to find the objects I can see on my viewport, but I cannot really find on my objects list. So what is this? Let me change the view to, well, that's too many polygons. We're not going to be able to see what's happening. Let me actually lowering the segments to something like 300, and that will make it more visible. Right, so, and I'm going to switch off the lights. Let me see. I mean, one of the shortcuts that I use a lot is NB to switch to, I think it's called corrode shading. I don't know what that, how to pronounce that anyway, but this is the one in which you actually see the polygons, and then NA to go back to the normal shading, or go around shading, whatever. Anyway, I won't try to say that. So NB to go to the polygon mode, NA to go to the normal shading. So I do this a lot to see with how many polygons I can get away. So what do I have here? Basically, to displace this background, and I did this in every other scene, I'm just reviewing it here because it's more obvious, I've got this map. Let me locate in it. Right. Let me open it in my Finder. So this is the displacement map. Again, really simple. This is not highly detailed because I just want this to physically pull the polygons of this plane. I think the original polygon count was something like 1,000, which is a lot, but oops. That's the trick. Let me go back to NA. And that's got enough details. And then I've got a displacement map in in V-Ray, which is using a different map from, I mean, the same texture, but it's using an actual bump map. And I believe, let me have a look. Yes, that's right. These 1, 2, 3, 4 craters are key. Let me go find this one. The right mess. These ones are actual separate objects, so I can place them wherever I want. But because, you see, they're kind of totally separate. But because the shading is the same, it does a trick. Like if I go back to my final compositing, you cannot really tell that those are different objects because it's the same texture. So hopefully that does a trick. And those are the four places from where the explosions are happening. So let me go back here. What I'm going to review in here is, what is it? This is an actual mesh, and in this mesh I've got, again, a rough, kind of an asteroid kind of map displacing the whole thing. So again, that's what gives me this type of render for the background. I've got a few lights, but I'm making sure that I don't have any lights. Just, I think I might have a white plane to bound some of the lights, because it's, if you have a look here, you see that it's pretty much black, but it's not 100% black. There is some light bouncing back from here, because even though there's no global illumination in the moon, I find that renders look really cheap if you go for 100% black light. So something like that works. You could believe that it's something like the moon or another planet, but it's still textured, if you know what I mean. And then from there, it's literally just the same thing that we saw before. It's mixing stock footage particles with the render, pre-rendered ones, and synchronizing the whole thing to the music. So now I'm going to play the final result again, the same trailer that I played before, so that you can hopefully get an idea of how the whole thing was created after these quick tips. And yeah, let's have a look.
Landing on the moon sparked more than a moment of joy. It opened our world to a whole new space. Celebrate the 50th anniversary of our greatest leap with programs that take you there and beyond. Continues all day today on BBC Earth.
And that's it. Hopefully you will get a better idea now of how the full thing was created, looking at those bits. Thanks for watching. My name is Carlos Galvez, and you can follow me on these social media that you can see on the screen right now and in carlosgalvez.com. Thanks for watching.